Admiral. She knew in her heart it was a mistake, but she'd been laid off and needed the cash, and her memories of the Strikers were mostly on the favorable side. So when Mrs. Stryker called, "Gretchen? This is Gretchen? Mrs. Stryker?" She'd said yes. She'd love to come over and hear what they had to say. First, though, she had to listen to her car cough as she drove across town. Fuel pump, that was her father's opinion, offered in a flat voice that said none of it was his problem, not anymore, not now that she was grown and living back at home after a failed attempt at life. And she nearly stole the thing, turning into the Striker's block. And then did stole it, as she tried against any reasonable expectation of success, to parallel park in front of their great rearing fortress of a house. It felt strange punching in the code at the gate and seeing how things were different and the same. How the trees had grown while the flower beds remained in a state of suspended animation, everything in perpetual bloom and clipped to within a millimeter of perfection. The gardeners saw to that. A whole battalion of them that swarmed over the place twice a week with their blowers and edgers and trimmers at war with the weeds, the insects, the gophers and ground squirrels, and the very tendency of the display plants to want to grow outside the box. At least that was how she remembered it. The gardeners. And how Admiral would rage at the windows, showing his teeth and scrabbling with his claws, and if he could have chewed through the glass, he would have done it. "That's right, boy," she'd say. "That's right. Don't let those bad men steal all your dead leaves and dirt. You go, boy, you go, that's right." She rang the bell at the front door, and it wasn't Mrs. Stryker who answered it, but another version of herself in a white maid's apron and a little white maid's cap perched atop her head, and she was so surprised she had to double clutch to keep from dropping her purse. A woman of color does not clean house. That was what her mother always told her, and it had become a kind of mantra when she was growing up, a way of reinforcing core values, of promoting education and the life of the mind. But she couldn't help wondering how much higher a dog sitter was on the socioeconomic scale than a maid. Or a sous chef, waitress, aerobics instructor, ticket puncher, and tortilla maker, all of which she'd been at one time or another. About the only thing she hadn't tried was leech gathering. There was a poem on the subject in her college text by William Wordsworth, the poet of daffodils and leeches, and she could summon it up whenever she needed a good laugh. She developed a quick picture of an old long-nosed white man rolling up his pant legs and wading into the murk, then squeezed out a miniature smile and said, "Hi, I'm Nisha. I came to see Mrs. Stryker. And Mr. Stryker?" The maid, she wasn't much older than Nisha herself, with a placid expression that might have been described as self-satisfied or just plain vacant, held open the door. "I'll tell them you're here," she said. Nisha murmured a thank you and stepped into the tiled foyer, thinking of the snake brain and the olfactory memories that lay coiled there. She smelled dog, smelled Admiral, with an overlay of old socks and furniture polish. The great room rose up before her like something transposed from a cathedral. It was a cold room, echoing and hollow, and she'd never liked it. "You mind if I wait in the family room?" she asked. The maid, or rather the girl, the young woman in the demeaning and stereotypical maid's costume, had already started off in the direction of the kitchen, but she swung round now to give her a look of surprise and irritation. For a moment, it seemed as if she might snap at her, but then finally she just shrugged and said, "Whatever." Nothing had changed in the paneled room that gave onto the garden, not as far as Nisha could see. There were the immense old high-backed leather armchairs and the antique stickly sofa rescued from the law offices of Stryker and Stryker, the mahogany bar with the wine rack and the backlit shrine Mr. Stryker had created in homage to the spirits of single malt Scotch whiskey, and overseeing it all, the oil portrait of Admiral, with its dark heroic hues and golden patina of varnish. She remembered the day the painter had come to the house and posed the dog for the preliminary snapshots, Admiral uncooperative, Mrs. Stryker strung tight as a wire, and the inevitable squirrel bounding across the lawn at the crucial moment. The painter had labored mightily in his studio to make his subject look noble, snout elevated, eyes fixed on some distant, presumably worthy object. But to Nisha's mind, an Afghan, any Afghan, looked inherently ridiculous. Like some escapee from Sesame Street, an admiral seemed a kind of concentrate of the absurd. He looked goofy, just that. When she turned round, both the Strikers were there, as if they'd floated in out of the ether. As far as she could see, they hadn't aged at all. Their skin was flawless. They held themselves as stiff and erect as the Aturi carvings they'd picked up on their trip to Africa. And they tried hard to make small talk and avoid any appearance of briskness. In Mrs. Stryker's arms, "Call me Gretchen, please," was an Afghan pup. And after the initial exchange of pleasantries, Nisha, her hand extended to rub the silk of the ears and feel the wet probe of the tiny snout on her wrist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.